Kenny Omega has made his return to New Japan Pro Wrestling, and a new AEW World Champion has been crowned. But first, let's get to the quickfire headlines as we take a look at the key stories from last night's AEW Full Gear pay-per-view, as the second finalist of the AEW World Championship Eliminator Tournament was named. Ricky Starks would advance through from the semi-finals after a victory over Brian Cage on last night's Zero Hour show, and after the match, he would be confronted by the other finalist, Ethan Page. The two are now set to meet this Wednesday on AEW Dynamite, with the winner challenging for the AEW World title at Winter Is Coming on December 14th, 2022. The first title match of the Full Gear pay-per-view would see the Death Triangle defend their AEW Trios titles against the returning Young Bucks and Kenny Omega, although the result was a surprise to almost everybody watching. In the end, Rey Fénix would use Pac's hammer that he was previously reluctant to use to fight his way out of Omega's one-winged angel, allowing for the roll-up for the pinfall win. AEW would later confirm that the two trios will compete in a best of seven series over the coming weeks, with the first to four wins taking home the belts. Last night's match will count towards the scores, with the next belt set for this Wednesday on Dynamite. Next, let's get to some news on talent that were backstage at the show but weren't used. Prior to the pay-per-view, Fightful would report that all four members of the House of Black were in attendance, although in the end they would not appear on air. It's been 2 months since we've seen Malakai Black, Buddy Matthews, Brody King, and Julia Hart, and it looks like we'll have to wait a little longer for their return. Another interesting name that Fightful reported was at the show prior to it kicking off was Marco Stunt, with many then expecting him to play a part in Jungle Boy Jack Perry's win over Luchasaurus, although he was nowhere to be seen on the broadcast. Whether he'll show up eventually remains to be seen. Saraya would wrestle her first match in 5 years last night at Full Gear when she defeated Dr. Britt Baker DMD in the middle of the ring. The win would follow a targeted attack on her neck from Baker, which was previously broken, but she would eventually score the pinfall after hitting her newly named finisher, the Goodnight DDT, a nod to her family name, with it previously being known as the Rampage in WWE. The next match would see a brand new champion crowned when Wardlow put his AEW TNT Championship on the line in freeway action. Whilst the War Dog wasn't involved in the fall, it was Samoa Joe that walked away with the belt after making Powerhouse Hobbs pass out with a Kikina clutch. This now makes the Samoan Submission Machine a double champion, adding to his ROH television title belt. Elsewhere on the show, the interim AEW Women's Championship was on the line, with Jamie Hayter challenging her former friend and roommate Toni Storm for the title. After interference from Hayter's friend Britt Baker, who hit a curb stomp onto Storm on the title belt, she would later manage to capitalize on the exposed turnbuckle before dropping her opponent with a Haytergade for the pinfall win. Later in the night, a top team would then go their separate ways, this during the bout for the AEW World Tag Team Championships. Swerve and Our Glory would battle the Acclaimed in an attempt to win the top prize in the tag team division, but in the end, Keith Lee would get tired of Swerve Strickland's antics, walking out on his partner, allowing the Acclaimed to retain. Before the show, Fightful would report that a singles feud between Lee and Swerve was implied to them, which now seems to be the case. We'll come back to the main event of Full Gear later on in the video, but first, let's get to some news from the NJPW Stardom Historic Crossover Show, where the main event would see the first ever IWGP Women's Champion crowned. Kairi would battle Mayu Iwatani in the final of the three-round tournament in a match that lasted 25 minutes. In the end, it was Kairi that walked away with the title after connecting with an insane elbow from the top for the 1-2-3. Many fans did expect an appearance from Sasha Banks, aka Mercedes Varnado, at either Full Gear or Historic Crossover due to recent trademark filings, although this wasn't the case, with it now likely that she'll fill the final spot in the Women's War Games match at WWE Survivor Series. The Historic Crossover Show would also see the final New Japan match of a legend of the promotion, when Great Muta teamed with Kazuchika Okada and Toru Yano to defeat the United Empire's Great Okan, Aaron Hernair, and Jeff Cobb. Okan would attempt to mist Muta during the match, with it being avoided, before spraying him with a mist of his own. Okada would later put Hernair away with a Rainmaker, scoring a victory for his team. Muta is in the midst of his retirement tour and will hang up the face paint of his demonic character on January 22nd. When he teams with AEW's Sting at a Pro Wrestling Noah show. Before Now and Then, he will also take on WWE's Shinsuke Nakamura in singles action on January 1st, also for Noah. With that said, his final match altogether will occur on February 23rd, when he appears as himself, Keiji Muto, in his last ever match. And next up, Kenny Omega has made his return to New Japan Pro Wrestling. As mentioned this morning, New Japan Pro Wrestling and Stardom would link up with the two Bushiroad promotions hosting their first ever joint show named Historic Crossover. One of the matches on the card would see Will Ospreay successfully defend his IWGP United States title against Shota Umino. It wasn't long before the Commonwealth Kingpin discovered his next challenger, however, when former IWGP heavyweight champion Kenny Omega made a shock appearance via video message. Omega would appear on the big screen during Ospreay's celebration in his first New Japan appearance in almost 3 years, when he talked about the US champion's role as the top gaijin in the company, a role previously held by himself. He would first cut the promo in Japanese and would say, "It's been a long time, New Japan Pro Wrestling, now why do you think I'm here? When AEW was built, nothing was keeping me in New Japan, so I had to be replaced. And just who was that replacement? Oh, it just had to be the masterful William Ospreay. And how did that turn out? Take a look, the crowds have gotten smaller, we can't hear them cheering. Oh, but that's because of the pandemic, that's the line you trot out, right? But is it really? You see, there's one real virus here, and that's you, Will. You and all your auto-translate-loving foreign pals. All of you are second-rate Kenny Omega knockoffs. I have to say, I was surprised to get the phone call from NJPW. And to be honest, I'm really not interested. But one more time, for the fans, for the good of pro wrestling, I'll show you what separates Kenny Omega from a Will Ospreay." Omega would then start talking in English to challenge Ospreay for a match at Wrestle Kingdom on January 4th and would say, "I will save the promotion. I will once again change the world. I haven't forgot what you've done and I'm coming for you. Wrestle Kingdom, Will. I'll be there. Till then, I must bid you adieu, goodbye, and good night." Bang. During his time in New Japan, Kenny Omega became one of the most popular names on the roster, both in Japan and internationally, with him taking his reputation to a whole new level during his time there. Omega's last match in New Japan occurred on Wrestle Kingdom 13 on January 4th, 2019, in the show's main event, where he dropped the IWGP Heavyweight Championship to Hiroshi Tanahashi, this before being announced as a founding member of All Elite Wrestling just 3 days later. The beef between Omega and Ospreay has been brewing for quite some time, with the two locked in verbal warfare for quite a while now, with this now officially set to spill into the ring at the Tokyo Dome. But who do you think leaves Wrestle Kingdom as the IWGP United States champion? Let me know in the comments down below. And finally, a new AEW World Champion has been crowned. Last night, the AEW Full Gear pay-per-view would be headlined by a match for the world title. We have Jon Moxley defending his belt against Maxwell Jacob Friedman, MJF. The match would see MJF cheered throughout, with the crowd not only turning on Moxley, but Moxley would turn on the fans, giving them the middle finger. The match would then come to a close when the referee was knocked down, allowing William Regal to get involved in a move that decided the ultimate winner. However, it wasn't his Blackpool Combat Club recruit Jon Moxley that he aided, but instead MJF, who would end up using the villain's brass knucks to knock Mox clean out for the win. The story leading into the match was that MJF insisted that he wouldn't use his Dynamite Diamond ring to win, but he didn't say anything about the brass knucks. Despite the heel finish, the crowd would continue to cheer MJF, although it seems that AEW will continue to try and get him booed, fighting against the audience reaction, but we'll have to see how it plays out. This was highlighted in the post-show media scrum that saw Max interrupt proceedings to discuss his win in front of the world, once again paying tribute to CM Punk's pipe bomb promo in 2011, and he would say, "Let's talk, shall we? AEW is now destination television once again. The ship has been steered properly. Once again, this belt is now the most important belt in the entire sport, and it stands for three letters, and it damn sure ain't AEW. I know for a motherfucking fact that it ain't M-O-X, it's M-J-F. You morons bit on every single word I had to say this past couple of months. I want to earn it, I want to fuck that. I deserve it because I'm the best wrestler in the fucking world, and every single one of you knows it. On the microphone, in the ring, nobody can touch me," which was the reference to the pipe bomb. "That's a fact, nobody is on my level. And then you guys believe me when I put over this motherfucker," points at Tony Khan. "Grow the fuck up. No offense, Tony, grow up." MJF would then end his rant with a reference to the controversial Jim Cornette, a nod to another one of his influences, and he would say, "If you want to know anything about the most important man in professional wrestling, you've got to tune into the MJF show. That's every Wednesday on TBS, and you know damn well that's Destination TV. Thank you, you bye. The champ's f***ing out, baby. What the future holds for MJF as champion remains to be seen, and it will be interesting to see if they can continue to push against the audience reactions by using the bidding war of 2024 as a heat seeker, with threats to take the title to WWE likely imminent. But what do you make of MJF's AEW world title win, and is it about damn time? Let me know in the comments down below. And before you go, make sure you check out the 12 most obscure WWE appearances from AEW wrestlers.